Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidina wa Nabiina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Ya ayyuhan nasu inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin aw untha waja'alnakum shu'uban. وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارَفُوا إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِندَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ خَبِيرٌ صدق الله العظيم.
First and foremost thing is, Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu, he was asked a question. His question was a very simple question. And Sayyidina Ali gave 8 words to this answer. How many words? 8 words. But in these 8 words, he covered the whole of what I might cover with you in 1 or 2 or 3 nights. Subhanallah. That's the, Allah gave Sayyidina Ali balagha. He gave fasaha and balagha. Sayyidina Ali, he could say a few things and it has so much rich meaning to it. So what did he ask him? The question was simple. The question was, what is marriage? What is marriage? What is it all about? Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu said first, he said, marriage is sururu shahrin. Then he said, what's after that? Sayyidina Ali said, ghumumu dahrin. What's after that? He said, kusuru dhahrin. What's after that? He said, nuzulu qabrin. That's it. 8 words. 4 couplets, 8 words, summed the whole thing up. Subhanallah, what a job he did. Number one, his answer was, sururu shahrin. What is marriage? Sayyidina Ali said, it is a month's worth of happiness. You guys thinking, oh, 30 days. 1 month worth of happiness. It didn't literally mean a month worth of happiness. It meant, you know, basically the beginning, few, 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, whatever. You know, you got your wife saying, you know, darling, what should I cook you? You know, parathas on the table, even for breakfast, right? And everything is running like clockwork, everything. That's when the golden days are. And guys, when you get married, and girls, when you get married, enjoy it. Because there's a time when that's not going to be there anymore. You're going to be ending up with your cornflakes on your breakfast table. End up with your little crunchy nut and the rest of it. And even if you want breakfast, she'll probably be snoring and telling you, you know, to go and get it yourself. But it doesn't matter. You know, it doesn't matter. Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu said, sururu shahrin, then he said ghumumu dahrin. The next thing he said was, so let's pass it forward. The next thing he said was ghumumu dahrin. He said it's the whole lifetime worth of what? Of, I don't want to use the word distress, but I'll use the word responsibility. It's a lifetime's worth of responsibility. And then Sayyidina Ali was asked, what's after that? He said, well, your back gets bent. Kusuru dhahrin. He said, what's after that? He said, nuzulu qabrin, time to go to the grave. Now you might think, what? I'm not getting married. 1 month after that, I get so much pressure that I get back bent and I go in the grave. Is that it? Now subhanAllah, Sayyidina Ali said a beautiful thing. Because he linked it to the next world. And guys, who's afraid of the grave? Who's afraid of the grave? Some of us are. But you know what? If you're prepared for it, the grave is a wonderful place to be in. The grave is a wonderful place to be in. Because it's either going to be a pit of hellfire or it's going to be a garden of paradise. So that's wonderful. Sayyidina Ali linked it with the grave right at the end. Why? Because marriage is not just about this world. And the people who get married, after a while, they realize that it's not just about this world. The whole akhirah depends on marriage. The whole of the next life depends on marriage. And why the Rasulullah said, he said, nikah, or your marriage, is half of your faith. Why he said half of your faith is because you and your wife together, you're going to complete faith. You're going to complete your iman. And I'll be honest with you, it is absolutely true. A person, how many of you guys are married here? Put your hands up.
got five guys that are married here. And the rest of you. I wish I asked the other sisters at the bottom as well, how many of them are married? You know? How many of them are married? And then I could have probably get an answer from them. They'll probably just do nikah straight here today, isn't it? Up and down, yeah? Huh? Allahu Akbar, huh? Somebody did takbir. Allahu Akbar. The thing is, five of you married, most of you are not married. The first thing a person thinks of when marriage is coming up and so on is, you know, you're just thinking about sururu shahrin. The first part of Sayyidina Ali's qawl, first part of his part, he said, you know, that month's worth, for some people it's 2 months, some people it's 3 months, 4 months, some people it lasts for a year. I've met some brothers, you know, even after 1.5 years, still they've still got that smile from one earlobe to another earlobe. Right? Then you know the brother, mashallah, is looked after, yeah? But that's good. And even sisters as well, some of them, they have a wonderful time. But, you know, there's a time when responsibilities are going to come. And when responsibilities come, it's not about sururu shahrin anymore, it's about ghumubu dahrin. You're going to start thinking now. Now, it's a very serious thing. It's not just get in there, get out there. It's not that. No. Those sisters, those brothers who are married and who've been married, they know what it is. Because, you know what? The biggest thing you're going to have to deal with is learning about one another. You have to learn about one another. You know, for you to live on your own as a bachelor, it's easy. You get up in the morning, you wear what you want, get out the door, come back when you want, done. When you're married, you can't do that. You can't do what you want, come home when you want, this and that. You've got responsibility. You've got a responsibility, and you've got to think about that. And you've got to take it seriously. So the next thing is, you've got to think about that. If you've got any kids coming on the way, you've got to think about them, their education, their deen. Lot of brothers, most of the practicing, in fact, I can say all of the practicing brothers I know, they're all thinking about their children when they're getting 3, 4, 5. What school am I going to send them to? Right? Then which Islamic school and so on. Now you think at that moment, if your wife knows the deen, and she knows it, and you're busy 9 to 5, and your wife's at home, subhanAllah, your wife can do, you know, she can do wonders for you. She can sit home, she can just read Fatiha, and the kid will learn Fatiha from the mother's mouth. She can sit home, she knows the deen, she can teach her child the adab, akhlaq, manners, ready-made. You don't have to sweat for it. You don't have to undo damage by taking the kid to a special, you know, boot camp or something later on, you know, to get him in gear. You don't have to do any of that. Some kids, they get to 11, 12, this and that, and it's getting late. Your wives, I'm telling this to the brothers, and to the sisters, what I'm saying is your husbands, so their deen. You don't want, first thing is, you don't want a brother that, you know, is a lazy little, you know, yeah, I'm talking to you brothers. Some of us brothers, and that's what I'm saying on behalf of the sisters, some of us can really love that sofa of ours at home, you know what I'm saying? Like, yeah, you just love sitting on there, and it's like, Fatima. And she goes, they laugh. Did you hear that? The brothers heard you laugh, subhanAllah. There's loads of Fatimas downstairs. So he goes, Fatima, bring me roti. And they bought tea. Otherwise, I give you sorti. Yeah? Gonna beat you up. I mean, that's some brother. It's horrible. It's a horrible thing. You haven't got to know each other. You haven't got the. You need the right type of mindset for marriage. And you've got to connect with one another. You know this whole idea, has this been covered by arranged marriages? Arranged marriages. Well, let me cover it my way a bit, right? Arranged marriages, yeah? Where they take you, and I've known loads of brothers. Loads of brothers, this happened, right? They're taken somewhere for a little dawah, this and that, they hardly know what's going on. Next minute they know they're sitting next to a girl. And they're wondering, where's everyone gone? After 5 minutes, everyone gets back together again, and I say to him, do you like her? And you say, well, hang on a minute, was that supposed to be my wife? You know, am I supposed to marry her? You know, they haven't even said salam. They haven't even opened their mouths with one another, and just one little glance or something. And on the looks of the face, they're supposed to get married. My God, I'll be honest with you, right? I'll be honest with you. There are some women that are very, very beautiful. Some men that are very handsome, yeah, very handsome. But you know, inside here, they're really ugly. They're really ugly. Because they've got a bad ego problem. Some men, some women, they're really handsome or pretty inside the group. And you know, some men and women, they might be okay. I'm not telling you to get married to someone who doesn't have any looks, otherwise you're going to get up right in the morning, you're going to look at her and say, ah!
I wish I was asleep. You know, we don't want to talk about that stage where you don't. No, no. Rasulullah said there's four things that you get. Have you covered this hadith, yeah? It's four things you get. What are the four things, quickly? Number one, Jamal, her beauty, her mal, her wealth, her lineage, and the fourth thing, her deen. And then he said, which one to choose? Her deen. And you know, for sisters, I'm saying it's the opposite thing. For your men, right, for your husband you're looking for, look for these four things, but definitely choose the fourth one. It doesn't mean you don't choose the other three. It means that if you get the other three, they're bonus. If you get a woman who's got her deen, or a man who's got his deen, and then they're handsome and pretty as well, alhamdulillah, it's nurun ala nur. If they've got money as well, alhamdulillah. And if they've got good high lineage as well, you know, Jat Chaudhry, whatever, Khan Saab, whatever it is, yeah, his daughter, then it's even Allahu Akbar, right? You can have that. But what the primary thing is, don't lose the deen aspect. That's one thing. But you know, in deen aspect, what the Prophet ﷺ said, it has a very beautiful part. Deen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has used in the Holy Quran, Maliki Yawmi Deen, master of the day of what? Not religion. What is it? Deen is what? What's deen there? They can say judgment, recompense. Master of the day of recompense. Deen means what you give to one person, you expect something back. That's deen. Yeah? That's deen. Rasulullah ﷺ said, Al mar'u ala deeni khalili, in a hadith of Abu Dawood. A man is he's on the way of his brother. Meaning that however his friend. A man is according to the way his friend is. فَإِذَا Rasulullah said, when you want to befriend someone, look at his associates and friends from before. For example, if there's a brother here called Ibrahim, and I want to get friends with him, then if I look at Ibrahim's friend, Musa, Isa, and you know, Khalil, whoever it is, I look at these friends, and I see that they've got some good character, I will know that Ibrahim has also got a good character, because good characters stay with good characters. Bad characters, they kind of get together as well, right? Chatty people, yap, 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 yap. Sometimes they love chatty people. Quiet people like quiet people, right? People who have got same ambitions in life like those same ambitions. People who are interested in education, you'll see them intermingling with one another more. People are interested in more, you know, business, they're together with one another. People are interested in whatever it is, people fall into categories. Now, what category does your wife or your husband fall into, and what category are you? It's important to ask these questions, because if you're an extreme, you know, if you're an outgoer, I've dealt with, listen, brothers, I'm saying this because I've dealt with a lot of, I've done a lot of nikahs, I've lost count of how many nikahs I've done, yeah. But unfortunately, there's a few in the society. You get, you know, you get divorces and so on. A few in the society, and you got to look at why. What's the reason? One reason I'd say. Is that the main reason I'd say that if they've had this kind of arranged marriage where they've never known who the other party is until they start, you know, meeting each other on the first night, and then they have to get to know one another, it's really sad. What does Islam say? Islam says, with your spouse, you can get together with her mahram father, yeah? Or her mahram uncle. I'm sure you've covered the fiqh of all of this, right, over the 2 days. But you need to be in that presence every time, even if it's on phone, you know, email, Facebook, all these other ways you got to connect with one another. With every single one, there needs to be the presence of the father, right? And if the father is not there, then the next best person who will be a person who will stop loose talk going on. That's the main thing. They're going to stop loose talk going on. So they will be there, and you can talk and exchange views. You want to get to know the person. So when you get to know the person, you've got certain questions to ask. What's your ambition in life? What do you want to do? How do you want to raise your kids up? Right? For example, I know one brother, one sister. She didn't want to send her kids to madrasa. They had an arranged marriage. He wanted to send his kids to madrasa. They got married. 1 year later, there was a divorce. Because they just didn't get the chance before marriage to ask these questions. Right? I know another brother, another sister, you could keep her 24 hours on the bus, train, car, outside, whatever, but she wasn't a kitchen woman. And he didn't want someone to cook and clean for him all the time, but he needed someone to stay home, you know, a bit. After a couple of years, there was a divorce. Because there's a certain extent you're going to go to try and make compromise. So what I'm saying is there's some crucial questions, and those questions you're going to have to answer. What, I don't know what all of your ambitions are, but the very crucial thing is to find out
what the ambitions are, what the characteristic is. As Rasulullah said in the hadith, Al-Mar'u ala deen khalili, a man is according to his character of his best friend or his friend. Your character is very important to find out whether my character gets on with her character or her character gets on with my character. It's really important. That's one thing. Has one of the speakers covered about istikhara? Yes, good. So you do istikhara. And you do istishara. Istishara is you ask, you consult with people. One of the best, you know, some of you, a lot of you guys are young, yeah? And I know the best thing you love to hear from my mouth. You love to hear me tell you, you know, guys, you just got out there, you just get married to who you want, you know, your parents are really old, and they don't know what's going on. They're living back in the 50s, and you're in the, you know, zeros or the 90s, where you were born then. That's rubbish. At the same time, if I said to your parents, you know, if I, you know, there's some committee members, our parents, and my dad was one of them, right? He loved it. He gave the Imam food on Thursday night, and then he sang his tune on Friday khutbah. You know what I'm saying? You never got that. He gives him food on Thursday, tells him what to say on a Friday, and the Imam's on the minbar on a Friday saying, talking about, you know, parents' rights, parents' rights, parents' rights. And for all those years I sat there, I thought to myself, scratched my head, and I said, listen, where's children's rights? Do we have any rights? Right? You know, one of my teachers said, he said every week he used to have a lecture in Bradford, and he used to have a good crowd of tafsir. And every week, you know, they used to come, and he's given all the rights possible, you know, in these talks. So one day, and there was one particular person, he used to religiously record the talks, and you know, those days was tapes, right? So he used to basically make duplicate cassettes and give it to everybody else as well in the whole society, yeah? And however many he could, right? That one week, he basically talked about women's rights. And that week, it was recorded as well, but it wasn't distributed. I wonder why. You know, you kind of think, where are these rights? You know, we've got an equal balance, so you've got to understand that they've got rights, we've got rights, right? We've got a whole thing. We've got to understand that we've got a right, yes, but our parents have got experience. My friends, all your parents have gone through marriage, they've got experience, and they've gone through the downfalls of life, and they don't want you to go through the downfalls of life. But I'm not just going to say, go home and just say, you know, Mom, who should I marry? And she says, that's it, you've only got one person, that's your cousin. You know, I'm not saying for you to go home and just get married straight away to your cousin next door. What I'm saying to you is that you've got to have a balance. You've got to listen a bit to your parents, and you've got to also keep your own decisions as well, what you want in marriage. Now, the thing is, the egos are the most important things. When you discover, like, I'll give you a thing. Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, he said, you never know a person, because once what happened is, a person came to Sayyidina Umar, and Sayyidina Umar asked a reference for this person. So the person said, I know this person. So he said, okay, you know him. Okay, so how do you know him? He said, yeah, I know him, I've heard about him. Sayyidina Umar said, did you travel with him? He said, no. Sayyidina Umar said, have you had a lot of dealings going on with him? He said, no. He said, have you been his neighbor or living with him? He said, no. He said, then you don't know this person. He said, what? You don't know this person. Thing is, when you live with someone, you get to know, subhanAllah, you know, the questions are getting... Sisters, can you stop the questions now, yeah? Because I won't be able to answer all of this. Thank you. Thank you very much for the questions, yeah? You seriously have got some questions, yeah? Our parents, this, that, subhanAllah. Okay. I'll try my best to get through as many as I can. I'm just going to talk as much as I want, and then I'll start your questions. So the thing is, you've got to find out about this person, how the person is, right? The egos are really, really difficult to deal with. I'm sure some of you have traveled with some people, you thought they were wonderful brothers until you travel with them. When you travel on a journey, and basically you got one sandwich, and then after, when lunchtime comes, you say, bro, where's that sandwich? He goes, I just ate it. You know, you find out about people. You find out when you travel with people, right? When you've got priorities, you got a toilet, and both of you have to go at the same time, and you see who's going to prioritize the other one, or your mate gets stuck in there for half an hour, and you want to go as well, you know, that's when you find out, you know, who a person is. These things happen when you travel. When you got bartering going on and you do business with people, all of you have done some bit of business probably in the society, you find out how people are when they barter with you. And the other thing is, when you basically live with someone, all of you guys know your family members inside out. That's because you've lived with them so long. Everyone has a different character. Now, you've got to find as best as you can from this, okay? So you ask the people who've been with them, ask the people who've traveled with them, ask the people who've, you know, lived with them, ask the people who've, you know, been with them in school, in this and that, and try and get an idea, right? You might not find out everything, and please don't do the one fault that some brothers do, is that they're looking for the person. perfect woman, or the woman that looks for the perfect man. Now I tell you where the perfect man is and the perfect woman is. Shall I tell you where they are? You can get one. Do you want one? Seriously, guy, do you want one? Do you want the perfect woman? And he says, do you want the perfect man? Yeah, shall I tell you where they are? They're in Jannah. They're in Jannah. Everyone in this world is imperfect. I'm imperfect. I've got faults. Only person that didn't have faults was Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Only people that didn't have faults were the Anbiya. Everyone besides them had faults. We've got faults. You can't find anyone perfect. So don't go on looking for, you know, one of my friends said, right? He said, you know, they all start off, right, with a big list. Has she got this? Has he got degree? Got this? Has he got that? Has he got this? Oh, he hasn't got that. He hasn't got that. Oh. He said, by the end of, like, basically, when you start aging, yeah? You've all got a sell-by date. You do know that? Guys, you're not married. You've got sell-by date. You know that, right? And girls, you've got sell-by date as well. Guys, when you're 30, that's your sell-by date. You might not be laughing now. You're going to be laughing then, I tell you, bruv. Yeah? You reach 30, you're not married. Women are going to be very picky about you. And sisters, your sell-by date is a bit lower than that. So you better get married by then. But you know what the brother said to me? He said, by the time they're coming near their sell-by date, yeah? They basically just say, oh yeah, has she got two eyes and two legs? Yeah, she's fine. Yeah, she's ready to. So, you know, you're going to start dropping things out of the thing, right? So, you know, try and balance it, right? Don't be so strict that you want to get everything. She's got to cook for you. This brother I met the other day, right? He's got to have his food particularly cooked. I said, listen, my man, your mother couldn't probably cook before she was married. It's a fact, isn't it? She couldn't cook like the way she's cooking. It's experience. Your mom couldn't teach her. Don't put that as a criteria on the thing that she's going to cook for me like the way my mom cooks for me. My God, you're causing a fitna already. You know, what do you expect the sister to be? Qualified in 5-star catering? She might as well get a job in a restaurant, you know, and not be with you. And a brother, you know, and if there's some parents here, please, here or downstairs, you know, don't make it that he's got to have a job, he's got to have a degree, MA, BA, everything, total fix, and he's got to have an investment in flat. And after that, maybe, then we consider his cousin for him. But yeah, maybe you consider. Now, the guy's going to basically be 28, 29 by the time he's even started. You know, most people got bank loans that they've got. Most people have got these loans, haven't they? Yeah? Student loans. By the time they pay that off, the guy's penniless, man. The guy, some brother comes to me, right, and says to me, this was some years back, he says to me, bruv, listen, man, I want to get married to this girl, yeah? And they're saying to me, you know, the mahar, the dowry is £20,000. 20,000. You think that's funny? I was in one wedding. I went there. There was one father here and the father-in-law here, right? So I'm in the middle and we're in the middle of the nikah. I said, how much is the mahar? 5,000. I said, no, how much is the nikah to him? He goes, 50,000. 50,000. How many did he say? 5,000. How much did he say? 50,000. 55,000. I could have been it. I know there's only 1-0, but there's a big difference, yeah? Right? They had to stop the function, go on in another room, have the little ramblings, right? Then they agreed on £20,000. Allahu Akbar. You guys are thinking, my God, I'm never going to get married. I'll tell you a trick, yeah? I said to the brother, he said to me, you know, how can I get married? He's got £20,000, man. I said, it's easy. I said, when you get married, just put it, yeah, agree with everything right now, £20,000, everything. When you get married with her, right, after that, and make sure this is in your nice hunky-dory days, yeah? When everything's going nice and well, and you're married to her, just say to her, as a good gesture of will, say, look, sister, you're my wife now, yeah? Me, penniless, yeah? Got no money, yeah? Then say to her, look, sister, please, accept something humble from me as the mahar. Knock off what you can, yeah? Is like, for instance, if you can afford £500, just say, look, £500, is £1,000 going to be okay with you? And if she says with her tongue, this is in the Quran, Suratul Nisa, beginning of Wal Muhsanat, yeah? The fifth juz, you'll find it there. فَإِذَا دَرَادَيْتُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ Allah said that if you are happy with whatever you agree with your mahar after marriage, that's fine, yeah? Say, sister, you want this one? Please, sister. And if she agrees with you, alhamdulillah, £19,000 knocked off, brothers. I said, deal's done. Yeah, or the sister, you know, alhamdulillah, jazakillahu khairan. If you do that for your brother, you made his life easy, your life easy as well. But obviously, you know, don't go to the extreme of, you know, taking the mahar down and then not treating people properly. No. You will obviously have to always look after your wife. Like, for instance, between me and my wife, you know, with money issues, this and that, there's never an issue, alhamdulillah. You know, whenever she needs money, she's got money. Whenever she needs a car, she's got her car. She's got a car, I got my car. Whenever she wants to go out, she can go out. You might think, Maulvi Sahib, what are you doing, man? You can't trust them, man. Maulvi Sahib, you're giving a bad example here, yeah? I'm not giving you a bad example. I'll give you a parable, yeah? I was in two madrasas. Dewsbury, 4 years, and Nottingham, I was there for 4 years. In Dewsbury, the rule was, you do not leave this madrasa for 3 months. Samajh gaye bhai, jana nahi hai. You wrote a little letter, can I go home? They went, ripped it up, rejected. So what do people do? They make the unholiest reasons to get home. Everyone's dying to get out. Whatever reason they can, you know, like uncle's coming, you know, whatever, chacha's flying out, you know, Granny Smith lost a cat or something. Whatever they can get home. Then I came to Nottingham, and the rule there was, you go home any weekend you want. First few weekends, man, the brothers were going up and down London and Birmingham, wherever. After a bit, what do you do? You think, I can go any weekend I want. No one was leaving. The madrasa was full, packed on a weekend. You know, the philosophy behind it is that if somebody traps you in a place, you want to get out of it. If somebody just says to you, you're free to go whenever you want, you make it your home. My wife, I told her from day number one, you want to visit your parents, you visit them as many times as you want. None of this Bengali business. I'm a Bengali, right? You know what the Bengalis do? They have this thing called Nayori. Nayori. I see the sisters are Bengalis downstairs. They're laughing. What Nayori is that basically it's a very official way to leave the home. And she's going to leave only after like 6 months. And even then, she's got to slowly bring it up with the mother-in-law and the father-in-law. And then they're all going to sit down and say, already you want to go? Already? Only 6 months? Oh. And then they give her 2 weeks only. And she's got to be back by those 2 weeks. It's custom, right? They do this. My God, I tell you, right? These sisters are crying out there. And you know what the thing is? You know what the solution to this is? If they told the daughter-in-laws, you can go as frequently as you want, I'll be honest with you, after a little while, they wouldn't want to go that frequently. My wife hardly ever goes and sleeps in her parents' house, and her parents' house is only 10 minutes drive from my house. Never sleeps there. Why? Because my house is her home, and she knows that she can go anytime she wants. Give freedom, but give it obviously with taqwa. It's not like she's going out, you know, doing something that she shouldn't do. No, no, none of that. She's got a hijab on, whatever. She knows where to go. She'll inform me. She'll tell me when she's coming, this and that. She'll say, out of respect, she'll tell me. There's none of these kind of, you know, I tell you so. Bukhari, hadith number this, you know. My right. Turn back. Come inside. Right. Where's Muslim? Where's my rights? You know, it's none of this business, man. Come on. You can't do that. You can't live together like that. And there are some brothers, subhanAllah, you know, so one guy, he was basically, you know, she stopped giving him his right. It's a sad one. She stopped giving him his right in the night time. So what he used to have the Bukhari next to him, right, with a page mark. He used to get out. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, husband has this right that if I told the husband to even bow down to his wife, then she has to bow down to his wife, right? What's the point? You know, you're going to stop. If you're going to make life difficult, then your life's going to become difficult. You got to take it easy. You know, there's a balance. At the same time, I'm not saying let them go out wherever they want, you know, shopping, dummy, and whichever shopping market they want. No. Zarura. Whatever is necessary, let them go. You go as well for your necessity. Alhamdulillah, there's a good understanding, you know, between yourselves. You have trust. You've got the whole marriage house completely fine. Trust is the main thing. I'll tell you with trust as well is that I know some of you brothers, you know, thinking, you know, first wife, then second wife, then third wife, and fourth. Listen, man, let me just be honest with you, right? I don't know, has this come up? No. Polygamy hasn't come up? No, right, sister's going to love this one, man. And brother's going to love you as well, inshallah. But, you know, one thing is, I told a person the other day, I said, you want to go back home, and you want to get, you know, a few wives, you'll find them. I said, but when a woman has got a red British passport, yeah, she's wahdaha la sharika laha. She's alone and she's got no one else with her. The brother's crying already. Astaghfirullah. Sorry, brother. Now, she's like, they give you that. The thing is, they're in Britain. They've got all the rights and all of that. Yeah, and I know some brothers who got married again afterwards, or their wife couldn't trust them. I'll be honest with you, you know, hell can break loose out in your house and you won't have a happy marriage, you know, after that. If you're going to do it, consult her.
talk to her. Let her know. Not behind her back. Don't try to tease her and this and that. And No. Be honest and open with it. And if she says no, and if that's how she is and she wants that, then I'll stick with one. Stick with one. Are you going to think, stick with one? I tell you, Rasulullah said what? He said in that hadith, he said, oh, young people, get married. And if you can't get married, what did he tell us to do? Fast, yeah? You know, a form of ibadah. If you do a lot of ibadah, it has a very good control on that thing between the thighs. Hope you understand. Ibadah, fasting, dhikr with Allah. If any brothers thinking, oh my God, red passport, oh my God, only one marriage, oh my God, I have to wait for another 50 years till I get my 72 in Jannah. If any brothers are thinking like that, well, you know, you do ibadah a lot more and you will find that your whole thing, everything will be controlled. Right? Second thing is, to the sisters I would say, it might be in your case sometimes good for you to find someone that could, you know, I know one brother who's married up in Bradford, yeah? He's married to two women, right? Two women. Both of them are good friends. One of them does all the house duties and the other one does all the education. Sort it out. She goes to the school to teach in a Muslim school. She basically teaches them all day, and the kids of the other one as well. And this sister, she cooks for all of them. Between them, there's 9 children. Between two wives, there's 9 children. And they all, alhamdulillah, I've talked to brother Prophet, I said, how do you sort it? He said, alhamdulillah, in one house as well. Sort it out. And the first wife basically chose the second wife. You know, and you know, sisters can do that. It's not the end of the world. But it's up to you, brothers and sisters, if you're going to do that. But don't break your marriage or make marriage horrible by the other person losing their trust. If you lose trust, you know, that's it. I'm telling you, there's nothing that can make your marriage again. It's a very, very important thing that you keep your trust together. Okay, so just a couple of other minutes as well. A few other minutes. A few things about our mentality. Men, this is what I'm saying to the sisters. When a man has a trouble, he likes to be reclused. He likes to basically be to himself. When a man has a trouble, he just likes to just spend time with himself. And a man doesn't like unsolicited advice. If a man hasn't asked for advice, he doesn't like advice. But the opposite is, when a woman has a problem, she likes to share and talk about the problem. That's her fitrah. It's inside her. And the second thing is, a man basically doesn't like unsolicited information. A woman likes unsolicited information. Right? It's different. We created different. All this business about equality in men and women, this and that. Listen, I'll be honest with you. You cannot get everything equal with men and women. You can get a lot of things equal. You know, don't get me wrong. You can get a lot of things equal in the society. But some things, they're not equal. You tell a man or a few men to go and run a nursery. Right, they're going to go bazookas inside here. I'm telling you. After, you know, first it's like, you know, a man hasn't got that affection in his heart to long term. A woman has. She's been given it. That's why she's she's a mother. She's got the love that a man can't give. That's why the Rasulullah said, when the person said, who do I look after most? He said, your mother. Who? Then he said, your mother. Who? He said, your mother. Then he said, your father. Why? Because the mother's love, there's you can't compare it. The mother's love. But a man, the qualities Allah has given him, with his strength and other things, a woman doesn't have. I'm talking about in general sense, right? In general sense. I don't want to, you know, cause all this, you know, inequality, this and that. No, I'm talking, look, there's a lot of things we're equal in. Already we're equal in. But there's some things Allah has given to a man and woman, they're not equal. Where did I get this thing about a man likes to be with himself? Look at Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When he was thinking about Makkah before his Nabuwah, where did he end up going to? Where did he end up just before Prophethood? The cave. Well, Khadija radiallahu anha, subhanAllah, she was the best wife of the Prophet. Why was she the most beloved? Because she understood that when her husband wants his time to himself, give him his time. In fact, when he used to come to the house, she used to already prepare the meals for the next few nights. It wasn't like, you know, stay now. Oh my God, I'm going to die here. You know, where are you? No, none of that thing. No. It's like, go to the cave. Where did I get this thing about the woman likes to share her things? You look inside the Quran, Surah Yusuf. The women who talked with one another about their problems. فَلَمَّا سَمِعَتْ بِمَكْرِهِنَّ أَرْسَلَتْ إِلَيْهِنَّ. The whole thing is there. You look at Surah Mujadala, the 58th surah, beginning. قَدْ سَمِعَ اللَّهُ قَوْلَ الَّتِي تُجَادِلُكَ فِي زَوْجِهَا وَتَشْتَكِي إِلَى اللَّهِ Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his time, a sahabiyah came to her and she complained about her husband. Right? And Allah used what? He said, the first thing he says, سَمِعَ اللَّهُ Allah has listened to the statement of that woman. Why? Women like to be listened to. So brothers, if you got wife's got a problem, just sit there, listen to her, she will love it. And sisters, I'm saying, if your husband just basically doesn't want to know any information, just don't give it to him. He'll be happy. Leave him alone. Right? He probably wants to get over his problem alone. And it's true. That's how we are in our fitrah. And there's a lot of things in this fitrah, in our natural state as we are. We've got to respect one another for it. For example, to a woman, sometimes small things can be major. Leaving your cup on the table after drinking your tea and not putting it away. Yeah, someone saying, that's right. It could be a big thing. But on the other hand, for a brother, there could be major things with some other things. Right? For example, he might be thinking, you know, I go out there and I sweat and I bring, you know, £1,500 a month to the house and paying all the bills, right? And is that nothing? But what you've got to understand is the mentality is different. To undo the things, how do you make it blissful? Give a woman a bunch of flowers. You're laughing, give it, you try it. She'll be happy. Give her a gift. A man, what does a man want? Give a man, you know, some sweet words. Even he might be angry, give him sweet words. Throw sweet words at him. Say sweet words and smile and say, you'll see him change. He comes home, he's not feeling that. You know, nice affectionate words. What did Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Aisha, subhanAllah, if you look at the relationship in Sahih al-Bukhari, you'll find out. They used to have a wonderful relationship of sweetening each other's, you know, mouths. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would start off with sweet words for her. She would say sweet words. And there used to be a smile and affection. And it only got lost at the time of ifk, when she got accused. And she says that the sweetness of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how he used to meet me, suddenly I felt this coldness. You know, he wasn't horrible, no. He just stopped the sweetness, that's all he did. And she felt there was something wrong. Sahih al-Bukhari, you will find it. There's a lot of, you know, there's beautiful ways they used to address one another. Beautiful ways to address one another. In fact, you know, listen to this, right? I mean, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the other thing is, guys, I'm telling you, yeah? You know the weakest man is? You know the weakest man is? And shall I tell you the strongest man? Go on, tell me. What's the weakest man? Shall I answer for you, yeah? And the strongest man. The weakest, you can't get weaker than that, is the one that hits his wife. He's a coward. The guy's a coward. Hitting your wife, hitting someone that you can, you know, someone that is not as powerful as you. And please, sisters, right? There are some sisters that do beat up their husbands. Right? It's true. I know some brothers that get beaten up by their wives, right? So, you know, if you're stronger than your husband, then, you know, have mercy on the guy. You know, he's already got 3 lumps on his head with the saucepans that you hit him on this day. But general cases, a man hitting his wife is a coward. You want to pick on someone your own size. Pick on a man. Pick on someone who's got the same muscular, you know, talent as you. That's different. But the strongest man is what? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لَيْسَ الشَّدِيدُ بِالسُّرَعَةِ A great wrestler who wins, you know, and he's a great wrestler. Great wrestler is not the one who can throw his opponent onto the ground. But the great wrestler is the one who can control himself when he's angry. You want to be the best wrestler as a man? When you're angry, learn how to control yourself. Rasulullah SAW gives you the stamp of the best wrestler. I mean, you're the guy. You know, people out there say, I got this, I got that. No. When they're angry, they can't control themselves. Forget it. When you can control yourself, you're angry. That's the Rasulullah SAW gives you a stamp of authority that you are strong. You are strong. Okay? So, the thing is, making, you know, sweet things, you know, go out your way. You know, sisters, go out your way. Make nice dishes for your husbands. You know, brothers, go out your way. Buy nice perfume, gifts for your wives. Right? Another thing is, you know, be courteous to one another with things. Look, it's not a man's job always to be in the kitchen, right? But there's nothing wrong with washing a few dishes. There's nothing wrong with that. And it's not a woman's job to do some of the things that men do and so on, but there's nothing wrong with, you know, fitting one another's roles now and again. Right? But the thing is, if we care for one another and we're honest about it, a lot of the problems will basically be sorted.